I'm going to introduce the first person here in this panel, Jones von Jonestein. And so for the last 6 years, Jones has been the visual arts department head at A Reason to Survive, an art center at National City. And currently he's the assistant curator at Bohm Gallery in San Marias, California. He has a BA in art history from San Diego State University and will begin an MFA in sculpture at San Diego State University in the fall. Is that right? Okay. Wow, that's awesome. And Jones is a lot of things, including a really fierce friend, artist, curator, and also recently won a prestigious award from the New York Times for the greatest beard of all time, as well as greatest name of all time. So if you guys can please join me in welcoming Jones von Jonestein.
Hello. Thank you, everyone, for attending our panel lecture, Scofflaws, Authority and Rebellion. My name is Jones von Jonestein, and I'm going to be your moderator today. I'm very excited to be here. As Roberto mentioned, I'm an art historian, a critic, curator, writer, and a multimedia artist. My own work is rooted in a little bit of culture, history, visual art, and hopefully it's humorous as well, as you can see from these slides. I studied both art and art history at San Diego State University and continue to live in the San Diego area where I currently teach art history at Palomar College. T-Bone Burnett once said that the difference between an artist and an artisan is bravery. Throughout the history of makers, there have been many for whom the standards of the day are merely hurdles to be leaped, consequences be damned, for whom rules exist only to be challenged, and the unknown offers more excitement than the comfortable, allowing them to disregard public approval in search of the more elusive rewards of discovery and invention, closely and sometimes embracing failure. In conjunction with the current exhibition, Scofflaws, this panel explores contemporary ceramic artists who buck conventional expectations and explore transgressive thought, aesthetic, and processes. Today I'm joined on stage by three fantastic artists, Bryan Czibesz, Brian Harper, and Roxanne Jackson. They're three quarters of the Scofflaws exhibition, and they're wonderful people as well. These artists will speak in depth about their work, and while I will speak more generally about the overall themes of the show and the current need for a strong army of Scofflaws. Imre Schrammel is a well-known Hungarian ceramic figurative artist with many public art commissions under his belt. In the late 1970s, he began firing bullets through large pillar-shaped forms of bone-white Hungarian porcelain. As you can see, the resulting sculptures are a snapshot of stress, fractured and straining around a wound, a record of distortion. Why would a well-known figurative sculptor begin making such jarring work? Schrammel's statements about the work imply that the summation of his feeling to a lifetime under dictatorial rule of one form or another. He is channeling his internal narrative into confrontational yet elegant work that is a result of a right turn in his creative process, the act of a scofflaw. Incidentally, Bryan Czibesz has been exploring his own family's Hungarian roots and work that has used history and displacement as source material in the work. These works are slipcast lithophanes made from CNC-routed plaster molds. On the left is the Archduke Franz Ferdinand, and on the right is his assassin, Gavrilo Princip. Here you can see work that's tapping into major historical narratives of the last century, one with a strong familial connection for Brian. Speaking directly to the American ceramic tradition, Scofflaws goes without saying that it is a tradition rife with artists who have broken ranks and plowed ahead into the unknown. California's clay history alone is one of a family of rebels. The sly humor of the funk artists like Arneson, the destroyed beauty of Peter Volkus's forms, the reinvention of the Japanese raku techniques by Paul Soldner, the explosive transformation inherent in Steve Tobin's bang pots, or Clayton Bailey's delightfully bizarre, performative, and kinetic works. If any of you are unfamiliar with Bailey's work, and even if you are, I highly recommend a visit to his website. You will not be disappointed. It is delightful and kooky. When speaking of American ceramic scofflaws, one would be remiss to not mention the exotic works by Georgie Orr, the so-called Mad Potter of Biloxi, Mississippi, a century earlier. An immensely talented potter, he ran towards the bizarre and pushed wheel throwing to its limits. One could make a strong argument that rebellion is at the core of making. To quote Peter Sheldahl, artists are unhappy people because they want something in the world that isn't there. And this is definitionally antithetical to trends. The creative acts of pleasing the public are often at odds, but transgressive works do, however, sometimes receive a warm reception. Ellen Atsui and Tara Donovan use trash in the case of the former and multiples of ordinary common objects in the latter. And both have had major museum exhibits around the world. But rebellion is generative. It is only actions that are against the expected that bring new perspectives and understanding to the world. As creators, we want to see ideas and ways of being realized, seen, understood, and accepted. An example of an artist pushing the boundaries of comfort include British potter Grayson Perry, whose elegant forms are enrobed in confrontational, controversial narratives. His lifestyle as a cross-dresser being merely one of the inspirations for his work. He also delves deeply into class, gentrification, and gender identity issues, slipping through a sincere message and humorous, almost silly surface imagery. Rebellion is common, whether in Banksy surreptitiously placing his paintings in major art museums, or Urs Fischer's large-scale public hand-building projects, where he invites the community in to fill gallery spaces with hand-built creations, we see Scofflaws in action, stepping beyond what is. And both of these works are about representation. Barton Ladis Benes is one of the boldest artists I can think of in recent history. In the early 90s, at the peak of the hysterical fear over HIV virus, Benes used his own blood to create works that were literally perceived as a public health hazard. He created a large series of works from syringes and perfume atomizers filled with his own infected blood that were encased in glass and chicken wire and hung on gallery walls. The series, entitled Visual AIDS, invited protests. As you can imagine, very few venues were willing to take the risk of exhibiting such seemingly dangerous subject matter and physical material. The works challenged public perception of the disease and individuals associated with it, threatening the comfortable and safe environment of the gallery and the arts community at large. In a similar vein, Roberto Lugo uses the traditional vessel form to threaten the norm by addressing issues of race, class, and representation, redefining the decorative object and assumptions about appropriate imagery, incorporating not only reflections from street culture, but also jarring elements like the Confederate battle flag. Lugo states that he, open quote, puts brown faces on pots because he wants you to get used to it, close quote. Gerardo Monterrubio uses the sleek curves of crack pipes and 40-ounce malt liquor bottles as forms. And these objects, because they're often striking bold color and eye towards tradition, successfully inject their subversive aesthetic into the whitewashed walls of commercial art galleries and high-end living rooms, altering the relationship between class, culture, and refinement. Additionally, Keith Wallace Smith has translated his exposure into violence into powerful large-scale figurative works that address gun violence and the disproportionate incarceration of black men in sculpture that are equally striking for their humanity as for their directness, such as this one, which seems to depict figures rising up literally from a broken home. Richard Notkin and Aaron Toole are both unabashedly political, broadcasting their strong anti-war sentiments and lack of faith in our current political leadership through Notkin's work's fixation on the possibility or likelihood of nuclear war, and Toole's practice of sending officials and government a cup with accompanying letters of protest is direct action in play. Another example of a modern activist artist is Ai Weiwei, who has repeatedly spat in the face of tradition with such works as dropping a 5,000-year-old museum-quality urn to create shards from a hole. The work opens a dialogue between aspects of fine art, monetary versus historical value, and conservancy and the preciousness of objects. He also presents us with an interesting case of failure when being a scofflaw perhaps doesn't work out as well, or at least unintended consequences, with his installation entitled Sunflower Seeds. It consisted of millions of hand-painted sunflower seeds and was intended to be interacted with the public. The museum visitors would be invited to trudge across the open field of millions of sunflower seeds representing the Chinese workers who created them. The unglazed porcelain seeds, however, when ground underfoot, created such a large cloud of superfine silicosis-inducing dust that it was roped off with a statement that deemed the health danger too great to allow further public interaction. In a way, however, the intended symbolism of the work seems to have only been reinforced by the closure. It could be said that periods of social unrest are correlated with an explosion of new art forms and the revitalization of the arts as a whole. If that is true, then we are more than likely standing at the beginning of an era of unprecedented artistic growth in merit, if not in funding. And as usual, it will be the rebels that lead the way. This is clearly relevant to our current political climate and about our personal need as the artists to see things made and send them out into the world that did not have them before. Art as rebellion, particularly as a shield against intolerance, is essential at this moment. Some believe art and those who create it are powerless, Why then do they draw such attention? Why do repressive regimes crack down on artists? Why did the National Socialists feel the need to ridicule the degenerate art of the then German avant-garde? The simple answer is that art and artists do have power. Because the art of those Jews, Romani, communists, homosexuals, dissenters, contrarians, nonconformists, weirdos, and countless others could illuminate other ways, in this case, better ways. Here it is important to make clear that even work that is not overtly political is suppressed. Artists of all stripe are actively stifled because the dialectic fostered by art is anathema to the authoritarian. I believe that the title of artist comes with real world responsibility. It is, in a very real way, impossible to be an artist without expressing your present experience. In the words of Nina Simone, you can't help it. An artist's duty, as far as I'm concerned, is to reflect the times. The people in this room have a power to change minds, soften hearts, and foster communication. The moment of history within which we live is going to require our artists, including all of us present, to work overtime, to spread reason and love, to foster understanding and mutual regard, to reject closed-minded rhetoric that denies science and basic human rights. And finally, we must project a spirit of open-minded inquiry and continue to shine a light into the darkness. The polite approach is no longer viable. Arts funding, already a frequent candidate for budget cuts, is poised to experience one of the most severe assaults in history. There is a strong likelihood that the National Endowment for the Arts and the National Endowment for the Humanities will be dissolved by the end of next year. And what is an artist to do? What is a citizen who cares about issues of kindness and tolerance and culture to do? First off, do not think that you are powerless and cannot enact change. Keep on making. In 2008, Yumi Hori did exactly this and organized the Obama-era campaign that enlisted over 70 ceramicists to make politically inspired work to auction off online, eventually raising over $10,000 for presidential campaign of Barack Obama and Joe Biden. This inspired a fairly traditional group of artist potters to make politically inspired work, as well as use their work directly to make change through raising funds to support the Obama Hope campaign. Here's one of my favorite pieces from the campaign by John Bird, the Palin Family Picnic, Annual Picnic and Book Burning Stein. I don't think there's anything more to say there. During the most recent election cycle, Hope Rivelto stepped up to the plate with her Still Divided Party Cup series, where she mass-produced slip-cast solo cups and then invited the public to decorate them with pre-cut ceramic decals and mix and match them. The results were truly democratic, as well as comical and biting. Two of our artists, Roxanne Jackson and Sasha Kuzer-Riebstein, have been actively involved in current political rebellion through a series of art exhibitions entitled Nasty Women. The movement was initiated by a seemingly casual Facebook post by Jackson, responding to Donald Trump's offensive comments during the last presidential debate, in which he referred to Hillary Clinton as a nasty woman. Roxanne's comment soon became viral and resulted in a successful exhibition in New York City at the Knockdown Center, which featured over 700 artists and raised over $42,000 for Planned Parenthood. The show has stemmed off into over 40 other, actually that's changed now, it's over 60, right? Over 60 nasty woman exhibitions around the globe, each raising significant funds for Planned Parenthood and other local organizations that support human and women's rights. Sasha Kuzer-Riebstein organized one of the satellite shows in San Diego, which raised over $15,000 for San Diego women, immigrant, and LGBT communities. While the movement was stimulated by comments made during the presidential campaign, it's become a much larger protest movement. These shows were so successful that Roxanne and the New York City Originators have been nominated for the MIT First Annual Media Lab Disobedience Award, which rewards an individual or individuals who engage in an extraordinary example of civil disobedience for the benefit of society. So far, the project has raised over $100,000. This panel, however, highlights just a few of the modern day scholars in Roxanne Jackson, Sasha Kuzer-Riebstein, Brian Czibesz, and Brian Harper. These artists are not only rebels in their practice, but also in how they approach the world of fine art and instruction. From the rock and roll aesthetic of Roxanne Jackson's pop culture reference loaded work, to the contrast between machine precision and the reinjection of the hand by Brian Czibesz, as well as the tension between beauty and revulsion, science and chance present in the forms, sculptural forms of Sasha Kuzer-Riebstein, and their socially conscious critique of material culture in the work of Brian Harper. These are artists who have eschewed the practical for the exciting and the unknown. Sasha Kuzer-Riebstein is the fourth artist in this exhibit. She had to bow out of the panel because you can see from the picture she has recently delivered a baby. She is, however, in the room, so if you have questions for her after the lecture, please do approach. I look forward to hearing all the errors and inconsistencies she feels like I made here. Okay. Sasha's work is visually aggressive and directly confronts ideas of beauty and conformity through the use of abstraction, with a direct link to figuration, in order to question our understanding of our own physiology and psychology, playing with the discomfort that accompanies our limited knowledge. As you can see in these two works, you had me at Rainbow Glitter, and every ship is unsinkable until it sinks. She is using the allure of gold and soft cascading drips to lure you into a work where you are then harshly confronted with swollen veins and distended organs, threatening collapse under immense strain. The work seems to drip with fat and bulge and fleshy undulations, creating a visceral attraction repulsion that rejects the premise that art should be pretty and digestible. In 2016, while a guest artist in residence at the Clay Studio in Philadelphia, Sasha wanted to further explore this balance between beauty and revulsion, attraction and disgust by working with the Mutter Museum, a renowned museum of medical anomalies, by creating pieces for specific individuals in the collection. This piece is an homage to Mary Ashbery, who suffered from dwarfism, whose tragic narrative is depicted in the collapsed skull of her fetus, who was subjected to a fetal craniotomy during delivery, after which Mary also passed. Yet this tragic subject is shrouded in beauty and lush, vibrant flowers, amping up the tension between life and death, brightness and morbidity. The next piece, With or Without You, was inspired by a pair of thoracophagous conjoined twins in the Mutter collection. Thoracophagous means that they share the same torso, therefore the same heart, and this is a condition incompatible with life. This piece captures the existential dilemma of such unusual condition, with two separate minds, individuals sharing the same heart, as well as the bleakness of their condition. Sasha has also begun exploring unexpected materials in her work and has begun cultivating crystal formations directly onto the ceramic forms. In her work, she is continuing the mix of dark and light subject matter while also injecting this new approach through the alum crystals grown on the branch-like forms at the top. In these works, Sasha has had to explore the idea of chance and unpredictability, both in the shape of the finished growth as well as the longevity of the material. To this end, she's done extensive experimentation to create engaging armatures upon which the crystals can grow, both to attempt to influence, while not fully able to control, the growth of the crystal, but also ensure that if the crystals do deteriorate over time, they will eventually reveal fully realized sculpted forms under the surface, allowing the owner a unique relationship with the object, which evolves over time, slowly revealing itself. Sasha has also begun to combine enigmatic forms and materials together to force the viewer to input their own assumptions and perceptions into the objects, such as in this mysterious work, Dark Side of the Moon. Here's a detail of her newest work, which is entitled Strange Territory. It's also one of the most ambitious yet in this series. She's creating fully realized installations, which are snapshots of imaginary landscapes in which forms are simultaneously recognizable and enigmatic, containing a multitude of media and playing with the idea of weight, with large rock formations made out of foam, layered with concrete and glittering resin pools, upon which her painfully executed porcelain amalgamation rests, ripe with flowers, life, organs, and plenty of ornate gold leafing. This is just a snapshot of the full installation, which you can see currently on view at the PNCA, Pacific Northwest College of the Arts, where we hope you'll come and see our full show of all of our artists and join us for our reception tomorrow between 5 and 8. Okay, now I'm gonna introduce Roxanne Jackson. Being around Roxanne Jackson is like hanging out with a rock star. I once had her pause in mid-conversation. In mid-conversation to sign a fan's chest and then return to our conversation with an apology for interrupting. And that is not a joke. it's a special kind of visual artist who has groupies. Her personality cracks with good spirits and irrepressible energy. She works harder than anyone that I know, and she's one of the most completely engaged artists that I've ever met. Roxanne currently lives in Brooklyn, New York. Her macabre works are black-humored investigations of the link between transformation, myth, and kitsch. Press for her work has appeared in the Huffington Post, Hypoallergenic, New York Times, and she's been an artist at residence at the Bemis Center, Contemporary Center for Arts, and the Ceramic Center of Berlin, Hunter College, Watershed Center for the Ceramic Arts, Oregon College of Art and Craft, and the Pottery Workshop in Jingdezhen, China. She's shown in China, Portugal, Romania, Canada, and such cities as London, Berlin, Vienna, and Leipzig. Most recently, her work has been included in Salon Zucker in Paris, France, and shown at Mathilde Hatzenberger Gallery in Brussels, Belgium. Jackson is the co-founder of Nasty Women, a national international art exhibition and fundraising project, and Heather Metal Parking Lot, a nocturnal outdoor heavy metal party held each summer at the Wasaic Project in Wasaic, New York. Please give Roxanne Jackson a warm welcome. Thank you.
Hello, I'm really excited to be here, and it's good to see you all. I used to live in Portland, and it's great to be back. So, let's get started. I have selected works here to show you from one series of mine, which is called Alienware. Just for the sake of brevity, I thought it'd be easier just to talk about one body of work. It takes a little bit of explanation. So, one thing that I'm doing with this series, or what they're about to me, is they are splayed heads that depict the undulating ridges of a hard palette. So the process is that I start with sculpting out of solid clay a head, and then I deconstruct it, splice it open, put it back together in various ways. And that process has led to various forms, and it's really inspired this work and taken it in different directions for me. An example of the initial starting off point for this series is I sculpted a domestic cat head. And this is usually how I start. So maybe in this image, you see some pieces here that remind you of a cat head. Maybe see some fang teeth at the top, or noses, or some ears at the bottom. And from that point, I will, like I said, splay it open, cut it apart, put it back together in various ways to mess up the figure or confuse the anatomy. And initially, what I wanted to do was sculpt also the interior of a cat mouth, or the hard palate of a cat, and think about how that form is very similar to the interior of a snake mouth. The reason why is I wanted to compare these two animals, because in contemporary Western culture, we often think that cats are, you know, lovable furry creatures that inspire kitsch, that are all over calendars and cookie jars. We see lots of memes. We know, for instance, that they hate Mondays, but they're gonna hang in there, and they can do no wrong. But meanwhile, I have a cat, and most people that have owned cats know that they're 1 second away from really being a wild animal, and in any moment can switch. I also grew up in a house that had a snake. We had a pet boa constrictor when I was little, so I have a fascination and appreciation for snakes. But what I've realized in Western contemporary culture is that people are irrationally afraid of snakes, and there is some real reason to be afraid of snakes because some are poisonous, but not very many. And I think what this stems from is that our creation myth tells us that snakes are evil. So initially what inspired this whole body of work is this idea of comparing and contrasting these two animals that have actually the interior of their mouth is very similar. And then let's see what happens from there. So we see some intestine necklaces. I like to use a lot of the same or similar visual language. We see some horns in this image that I think of as unicorn horns. As Jones mentioned, I also want to draw from myth, but I'm more interested in recreating this myth or even making a profound myth, because I like the ideas of duality in my work. Here's the other side of that piece. This is the first time that I've actually drawn from sci-fi horror. A lot of times with my work previously, I've drawn and borrowed images from horror films, mainly the moment of transformation when a human becomes a beast or vice versa. Because I like to think about what really is a monster or what is a beast. It's just something that's slightly beyond what we think of as a human or slightly beyond what we think of as an animal. So now I'm borrowing from the movie Predator. I like to have my work reference pop culture as much as possible for various reasons, but one is that I like the image of the predator. Another is that using an alien makes us think, or might make the viewer think, about ideas of transformation or metaphor when relating to the human. This piece is in the Scofflaws exhibition that's at PNCA, and I think it might be a better example to show you a little bit of my process. So I do start with an animal head. So you can see the image on the right is a spliced head of a mandrill. So the baboons that have really colorful faces. when I spliced that open and started sculpting from there, I didn't want the glaze or the sculpture to really show you what would be the interior of the head. That would be too representational for my taste. Instead of having viscera on the inside, I wanted to have the image reference cobalt painting on porcelain. This is more like Delft ware because this is a terracotta piece. Because I like this tension of inside a head would be some craft reference or some technique that's related to ideas of beauty and decor and ceramics. And then here we see again the use of unicorn horns, this time pierced with cheap earrings from H&M, and then also some intestine necklaces and more of the predator. This piece is also in the show at PNCA, Scofflaws. And here's an example of me starting with not one, but actually two cat heads. So I am a little bit obsessed with cats. And I believe that it's a good place to start when you just make work about your obsessions. So maybe if you look at the image on the right, you can see a cat head in here. There's one on the bottom that's splayed open. There's also one on top that's in the inverse, so it's upside down. What I was thinking about was if I look at my cat with a kaleidoscope, what his head would look like in that image, and then how can I translate that into a three-dimensional piece. So that's really what inspired this, as well as a lot of other things. You can see more reference here to the cobalt painting on porcelain. Also, I want to talk a little bit about crystal forms. I do use those a lot in my work. Usually, they're sculpted with ceramics, but sometimes I'll incorporate real crystals. One reason for this is because I love ceramics, and one of the many reasons is that I think of this process mimicking geology and rock formation. When I'm starting with a material that's clay, that's akin to mud, it transforms as I'm working with it. It begins as malleable, and then it hardens as it dries, and then when I fire in the kiln with heat, it becomes hard like a rock. So I really love this idea of me comparing my work or thinking about this process in relationship to thinking about the slow pace of geological time. When I think about that with using images in my work of a beast or an animal or a human, then what I think about is how that may reference our immortality, the parts of ourselves that are more expansive and less obvious and unseen. And I hope that viewers are able to contemplate that with my work. So the crystals help inform that. This is a more recent piece, and this is very similar process, but heads are spliced and then spliced again, so that this image is truly 3D. I'm just gonna show you two images of it, but I started with a baboon or a mandrill head, spliced it open, opened it up, and then sculpted a predator mouth again. This time sliced that open, opened it up. I'll show you a view from the other side, and then added all these other components. The glazing here is a little bit different because going back to this idea of geology in the work, I wanted to create a piece that was more like a mineral or more like a conglomerate rock that would represent our collective nightmare made up of all these monsters or beasts or these images. And what I hope happens with the viewer is that they're drawn in by this glaze that recently someone has called candy glaze. And as they engage with the piece and walk around, they may see more and more images in there. So more and more may be revealed to the viewer. So I like this idea of a slower pacing with the work and in an effort to get the viewer to spend more and more time with my pieces. And here's just another view of the same piece called Indigo Kush. We're in Portland, Oregon, so I feel like that's pretty appropriately named. And another one from the same series called Cat Bite. The title of this was inspired by some recent events, which is too much to talk about here. But now maybe you see some claws, which are also can be viewed as teeth, again, related to the predator. You see some more intestine necklaces, crystals, and so on. I'll show you another angle of this. This is a good example, going back to the first image I showed you and what I talked about, of a depiction of a hard palate, which again may be interpreted as another body part, such as a rib cage or another body part. Again, in an effort to deconstruct the image of a human or an animal and confuse anatomy. I threw this piece in here, Snake Lamp, because one thing I'm also doing with my work is kind of poking fun of the ceramics medium and our tendencies in this medium. Of course, I mean this with love, but one thing that I've seen over time, and I also teach ceramics a lot, is that sometimes if there's a physical function attached to a ceramic sculpture, the maker may think that the work is more valid or more worthwhile somehow. For instance, I have a lot of students that will make a convoluted sculpture and then stick a stick of incense in it right before the critique, thinking that that's gonna give it more function and more importance. And I like to tell them and remind myself and tell you that I think that a sculpture, if it makes you think of something for the first time or see a new image, then I think that that is a valid function in its own right. So the title of this piece, Snake Lamp, this isn't really a lamp that illuminates, but I like that implied physical function. So here we see a snake with an open mouth, also a spliced head, a little nod to the sci-fi film Tremors. And then the last piece I'm going to show you, Easy Like Sunday Morning, is taking these ideas based on the Alienware series, but putting it in a trope that we understand and are all too familiar with, which is a truncated figure of a stagnant bust of a female. But what happens here, or what I want to happen, is that there's an explosion of activity really where her face should be, and hopefully to entice the viewers or get the viewer to think about, again, something beyond ourselves. And then this is just a side view of both parts sort of having a face-off with each other, and it's important to accessorize well. And with that, I'm going to mention Brian Harper, let him get started. Thanks for your time.
Oh, you're going to introduce Brian Harper.
Thank you. Thank you, Roxanne. That was fantastic. Okay, now I'm going to introduce Brian Harper. I met Brian Harper in a beer garden in Berlin. That's a true story. And his beard was smaller then. And browner then, too. I suppose both of ours were. Brian is a multi-talented individual. He is someone who just does. Much of his work is heavily influenced by social critique and compassion, and I think what he contributes is really valid. Brian Harper is currently an associate professor of fine art and the ceramics area coordinator at Indiana University Southeast. He holds a BFA from Northern Arizona University and an MA and an MFA from the University of Iowa. His work has been exhibited in over 80 national and international exhibits, including 7 solo exhibitions. In addition to his studio practice, he is the founder of ArtAxis.org, which is a growing online network of nearly 500 contemporary artists that serves as a way to keep artists and viewers connected and communicating about ceramic art. He has recently received grants from the Great Meadows Foundation and IU Worldwide, and currently lives in New Albany, Indiana, with his wife, Tiffany, and their 2 dogs, Oliver and Crunch. Please welcome Brian Harper to stage. Thank you.
Thank you for being here, everyone. And thank you to Jones for putting together this panel and the exhibition. I might be a little biased here, but I think it's a really good exhibition. And we're looking forward to seeing everyone out at the opening on Friday. And it's been a really, really interesting and fun time working with the other panelists on this project, too. I got a little nervous right before here when we were sitting, and I looked over at Roxanne's notes, and the first 2 words were flayed heads. And so I was like, oh shit, I'm out of my league on this one. So it's really been an honor. So so my name is Brian Harper, and I'm an associate professor of fine art and ceramics program coordinator at Indiana University Southeast in New Albany, Indiana. I'm also the founder and the executive director of ArtAxis, which is a 501c3 nonprofit organization and that promotes the professional pursuits of artists in the field, as well as the field itself. Our website hosts the work of nearly 500 artists and is viewed thousands of times every day from countries around the world. If you're interested in checking it out, I recommend you go to it. It's artaxis.org. So I'd like to start by talking about a couple of people that have influenced me in relation to the topic of this panel. Aaron Swartz was a programmer, a writer, an internet activist, and a social organizer. At age 12, he built a website that pooled the collective wisdom of the public by allowing anyone to post information on any topic and have that information edited by others knowledgeable in the field. And if that sounds familiar to anybody, right? Wikipedia was founded 3 years later. And his brother recounted this story of when his when he was in high school, his teacher told him about this great resource called Wikipedia. And he responded and said, yeah, we've had it in our house for like 5 years. You know, and it's astounding to me that at 12 years old, Aaron was not only formulating his belief in the non-hierarchical sharing of information, but he was actually building the tools to enact that vision. As a teenager, he went on to build the protocols for RSS feeds that help share news online. He co-founded and wrote the programming code behind Reddit. He worked with Lawrence Lessig to build Creative Commons, and he founded Demand Progress, the organization largely credited with stopping Congress's anti-internet sharing legislation known as SOPA and PIPA. Anyway, I could easily spend this whole time listing Aaron's contributions, but I wanted to share this quote of his that I ran across while researching him one day. And he said, "It's not enough to live in the world as it is." And when I heard him say this, I was struck by the simplicity of this. You know, it's not enough to live in the world as it is. And all of us in the room, in this room, have benefited from the efforts of the people that came before us. And it's not enough for us to only take from those resources. We must realize our responsibility that we have to give back to the resources that feed us. Another influence in relation to this panel is Grace Lee Boggs. Grace Lee Boggs was an activist, writer, thinker, social and political organizer. She spent most of her life fighting for civil rights and racial, social, and gender equality. Based out of Detroit for most of her long life, she saw the blight of Detroit as a chance for rebuilding, not as a detritus to leave behind. Even as conditions worsened in Detroit, she said, quote, "I feel bad for anybody that doesn't live in Detroit," end quote. Like Aaron, a whole lecture could be devoted to Grace, and probably a whole conference could be devoted to her. But I wanted to take this time to share this quote as well. In American Revolutionary, a documentary that chronicles her life, she said, "You make your path by walking." And again, such a beautiful and powerful and simple statement. You make your path by walking. And by getting out there and doing. I carried these thoughts and Grace's words when I marched on Washington, D.C. during the Women's March in January with my wife and so many of the strongest women in my life. Aaron Swartz and Grace Lee Boggs both pursue their goals by thinking unconventionally and in a non-hierarchical way. I am drawn to the same in my teaching, my practice, and my efforts building Art Access. With my work, I have long been interested in the non-traditional methods of building ceramic objects. The scaffolding series, one of my recent bodies of work, is indicative of this approach in that I'm primarily working with the ceramic material after it's fired. In this work, I begin by making thousands of extruded pieces of earthenware and firing them to cone 2 in an electric kiln. I do this to create a new raw material of sorts, a material that I can then use to build my ceramic objects. In a painstakingly slow and often mind-numbing process, I carefully plan and build these forms using epoxy mixed with black mason stain to create the connection points between all of the smaller parts. Encased in these earthenware scaffolding forms are ceramic objects from the JCPenney Home Collection. Chosen for their stark plainness and their seriality, I am also particularly drawn to JCPenney's use of the word home to advertise and sell these plates and bowls. When one thinks of the home, we think of the intangibles of a place. We think of the smells, the colors, the light coming through a window, the people and the pets. You think of all the things that make your home uniquely your home. In the JCPenney Home Collection pots, all of the notions of these intangibles are removed, and what's left are maybe the most visually plain pots I can possibly imagine. They are sort of like default pots. Yet despite this, I still feel in many ways a connection to the material they are made from, and in some ways, their seriality can be a really beautiful thing. With this in mind, I build these quasi-handmade scaffoldings to isolate and study these JCPenney pots. Focusing in on the home collection logo, I aim to highlight JCPenney's co-opting of that word by referencing architectural and house-like structures in the forms I build around them. In the scaffolding is also a reference to the study or the repair of something, as buildings are often wrapped in scaffolding when they are being restored or repaired. I spend months on each one of these works, and that slow pace allows me the opportunity to analyze every single angle on these vessels as if it were an architectural form and I was standing on the scaffolding myself. JCPenney advertises the home collection pots as being, quote, timeless. And I guess they kind of are in a way. I mean, they are void of any reference to people, place, or anything unique that would put them in a moment of time. And in a way, I can appreciate that, but for all of the opposite reasons, I love and collect handmade pots myself. And I'm torn here. On the one hand, while I hate their plainness, I can't help but appreciate how these pots are pared down to the barest essentials. In the store, they are stacked in ways that make them really beautiful. And you know, I stand there and say, how can this be? How can I be drawn to this? You know, they're like the antithesis of this whole conference. And I make handmade pots myself. And not a lot, but sometimes, you know, as my students can attest to. But sometimes I make pots just so I can have something to bring to the NCECA cup sale. But I also run a university ceramics program in a fine art program where I push my students to build creatively and foster their uniqueness. You know, and I manage one of the largest collections of handmade ceramic work online. Like, I can't really like these pots, right? I mean, I have to think those JCPenney pots are bad pots, right? Thank you for being here. And and we will, we're excited to see everyone at the opening on Friday. You all be there, right? All right, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Brian. That was excellent. Brian Czibesz. I first met Bad Mash, which is what Czibesz is my R, so that was pretty good to learn. First met Bad Mash when he was in graduate school at San Diego State University under Richard Burkett, where he was exploring an intersectionality between modularity, the body, and the machine. A few years later, during the Philadelphia NCECA, I ran into him at his studio at the Clay Studio in Philadelphia, where he was a resident and he had recently shifted his work towards historical and technological intersection. Several years later, I had the pleasure of being studio mates with him in the ICS in Kecskemét, Hungary. Czibesz has been crossing the country delivering workshops on how to build your own custom designed and built by him, extruder type 3D clay printers. And with a small budget and readily available parts, built in a few hours. A Johnny Appleseed of a new technology. Pardon me. Johnny Appleseed of a new technology. But it is not a new technology at all. It's one already established in industry. Much like silk screening was an industrial technique brought down to small-scale DIY by bedrooms, garages, and campuses in the 60s, 3D clay printing is being brought down practically and inexpensively to the hands of artists by helping to put a powerful tool into the maximum amount of hands. Czibesz is working towards a critical mass of active and engaged practitioners. Originally from Ohio, Brian has earned his MFA from San Diego State University and a BA from Humboldt State University, and has shown his work in solo and group exhibitions around the United States and internationally, including the Houston Center for Contemporary Crafts, the Center for Craft, Creativity, and Design, the Riga Porcelain Museum in Latvia, and the Ceramics Annual at Scripps College. He has taught at Arcadia University, Rowan University, and has been artist in residence at the Clay Studio in Philadelphia, the International Ceramic Studio in Kecskemét, Hungary, Creta, C-R-E-T-A, Roma, and the University of Hawaii at Manoa. He is currently assistant professor of art and ceramics at SUNY New Paltz. Thank you. Welcome, Brian. See you guys on the stage.
Thanks, Jones. And thank you to everyone involved for organizing this exhibition and this panel. the amazing Scofflaws here. Well, last thing about Jones, if you have a chance, I won't explain this now, but you can ask him about it. The difference in Hungarian between the word soproni and soproni, he can go on about that.
There's a difference.
There's a big difference. So we had a great time in Hungary. Anyway, I actually remain pretty uncomfortable about my status as a scofflaw, particularly in the context of the artists that have been presented and these people, and the Nasty Women projects, which are essential and incredible. And perhaps I'll skip through this quickly and we can get to maybe some more interesting issues. But I actually believe that there are some ways that I fit in here, and I'm going to talk about these three ways. But if we dwell on this first slide for a second, and to kind of piggyback on what Jones was saying, I think of myself as a technologist, and that's probably not the way that you think about technology. So while I work primarily with the digital and algorithms and 3D printing in one way, and that's the way we think about current technology, I actually understand technology as part of a continuum. So how you grow food, or the way fire transforms clay into ceramic, those are as much of a profound technology as a stupid 3D printer or an iPhone in your pocket or some other things that we think about in terms of current technology. And this is a view that sees our relation to and our manipulation of materials to make things as a really indelible human quality. Further, because this technological knowledge is actually cumulative, it's not about secrecy and proprietary technology. Technology is really about sharing knowledges and resources. The 3D printing surge that my work has been based on is not the result of the original patents that protected the knowledge exclusively, but about the broad and democratic dissemination that came after the patents themselves expired, when they became part of the public domain, and the global community that has rejected their use as simply exclusionary strategies in capitalistic business models. So groups like RepRap, which is the desktop DIY 3D printing community that's responsible for the global knowledge base, and artists like Dries Verbruggen in Belgium and Jonathan Keep in the UK. These are the people that I acknowledge as anchor points, but as part of a giant community of people who share resources. Lewis Hyde, in his recent book, Common as Air, leverages this idea by demonstrating a suspicion to the current idea that creative work is intellectual property. I'm suspicious of this thing too. So that's the first way, so rejecting the idea that technology is tied exclusively to protected rather than shared and public intellectual knowledge. But as Jones mentioned in an earlier slide about the problem that launched the First and Second World War, that was the result that led to a diaspora. I've been working on what I refer to as an ongoing project just called Magyarország, which is the Hungarian word for Hungary. And this work has as its genesis my dissatisfaction with the lack of objects from my family and cultural history. So my family, like so many others in the first half of the 20th century, were forced to flee from their lives in Europe. And this work that I've been making is a rebellion against the logic of war and conflict and the lingering problems of diaspora. This question of refugees, and I should acknowledge that my family was welcomed into the United States when refugees. This is germane to many current socio-political conversations that I'm very interested in. But this ongoing project, which I refer to as Prosthetic Histories, is where I'm exploring the use of digital appropriation technologies, in this case, digital 3D scans of public and private objects that may or may not be able to be turned into these missing cultural and family history artifacts. This is a prosthetic means of me reconstructing this ephemera. And I've been exploiting, I don't press my computer button, I press this button. I've been exploiting a combination of digital and analog in the making of this work. So these are modes of manipulating ceramic material that's my attempt to conjure these things that don't exist, to reimagine things lost or destroyed. And in this example, this is an inflated scale reproduction of a small China-painted porcelain mug that belongs to my father's cousin, which belonged to her great-grandmother, And it is so precious to her that she refuses to deface it, she says, by gluing the broken handle back on, and she keeps it in place with a rubber band or with tape. And its fragility is something that I hope this object maintains while trying to reproduce it into something else. So these resultant objects are constructed in what I refer to as continuous scribbles of line, which are entirely a handed process despite being the result of a 3D printer. And it's in a continuously engaged act of making that's shared between me and the machine. It's a search for form amongst all this immutable data that I collected, which is infinitely reproducible and identical in every iteration. I'm rebelling against the precision of the machine here and rejecting mechanization as a potentially inauthentic way of remaking this work. So the results are cloaked in this manic gesture of searching. In order to make this work, and wanting to leverage as many tools as possible to conjure these objects, it actually seemed important, and this is kind of taking a step back, it seemed important that I build the machine that would help to build the objects. This was actually my original impetus for ceramic 3D printing in the first place. I was confronted by the digital as a process that was both compelling in the context of this project, but limiting, because the output was always a transitional material.
What?
And so this last example is from a scan of a World War II memorial statue that has memorialized on the base my paternal grandmother's family, one of her cousins. And I think that the cloaking, the gesture, and the evidence of the form hidden in this noodly mess, this noodly search, I think is particularly fitting in the image on the right. So from that somber thing, I'd like to shift to a second project to talk about another way that I think my work is potentially aligned with the themes of this show, which is rebellious. And this work is a collaboration that I've done with the artist John Spangler, who's a potter. And the show is entitled Future Archaeology, and I'll explain that maybe again in a second. But this work further rejects the idea of the proprietary. And it takes a series of historical objects as anchor points in a back and forth collaborative dialogue of making and remaking. So through a series of analog and digital ways of looking at with scanning processes and then reimagining and reproducing form, we're seeking to embrace a certain friction inherent in the convention and invention binary that is at the core of object making. Whether things are reproductions of things that have already existed or whether things that come into existence are their own new and distinct and authentic thing. So the silver objects in this collaboration are the digital reproductions of the original objects. They're from scans, from digital scans, and prototyped. And they act as the anchor points to the rest of the work, which are iterations of these forms, rarely whole, most often in parts, and most often kind of lost. And our process is kind of like constructing a genealogy, or in some cases more like the results of the things that grow in a petri dish, where aberrations and mutations become their own things. And this is a giant search in small output to ways of understanding these objects in the context we understand ceramic history, ways of making across time, and our current technological moment. So I'm really interested in new tools. But I'm as interested in old tools, and I see the potential synergy between direct hand manipulation and digital precision, between fluid expressivity from the body and new marks, new gestures, and new languages that are conceived in concert with mechanization. In many ways, this work is both a celebration and a rejection of the promise of technology. Its precision is certainly what we want, I think, from technology, but also, like many things, once we get what we want, we find that we actually want something else. Or we want something further, something more. This process begins to work equally forward and backward. Regardless, it's a search along a continuity of making. And these objects, like most, are essential and significant while at the same time future archaeology. And finally, I wanted to say that this work is a rebellion against one last thing about the digital, which I think makes people suspicious of it. It's the idea of the hermetic and untouched output of the 3D printing machine, of a digital process, where the handedness or the making seems to be embedded in a front-end logic which is inhuman. To me, there are few things that are less interesting than the plastic objects that come off of a 3D printer. But the 3D printers, the DIY extrusion-based ceramic 3D printers that I've been working with, are machines that have as their output something that's not foreign. It's wet clay, and it's simply clay, which can then be integrated into any other ceramic studio process. These things can be cut apart, attached, recombined with hand-built, thrown, slipcast, whatever other kind of parts that you work with, and then fired in the same way and embedded in the same logic of ways of making. And this is what makes them attractive and not foreign to me. The results democratize the tool as much as my interest in disseminating the knowledge base and democratization of that through workshops. So in many ways, I think I actually reel against my own work in some of this, and the history of my own work, as I believe many of us do, which is a constant discovery struggle where we're prying at ourselves like oysters, perhaps, or pulling the curtains back to reveal something or tearing apart packages at Christmas, hoping that there's something new there. This is trying to reveal something, but the result is often dissatisfaction. And by that I mean it's a drive. It's a drive to make new things and to see what conventions and comforts we can shed, but most importantly, to see what rules of our own we can break free from on the way. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. That was excellent. Okay, so we're going to engage in a short, moderated question and answer session with the artists. And so I'm going to just ask them the questions and hope to generate a dialogue. Okay. So the first question that I wanted to ask is, in broad strokes, maybe in specific examples, what do you think that the larger theme of authority and rebellion mean for your practice or for the greater community in general?
Sure. The way that I interpret that question is what the role of an artist is. And I think that that's a question that's hard for me to answer, or I'm interested in answering that in a blanket statement. So I'll talk from my perspective. It's always been really important for me to be contrary or to ideas of the status quo as an artist. To me, it is very important for artists to assume this role, one that shows work that is object, demonstrates work that is transgressive, as opposed to only making things that are comforting, utilitarian, or beautiful. And I talk about these things specifically because when working with the material of clay, with its strong historical ties to ideas related to comfort and beauty, for me, it's always been a natural inclination to just express ideas with this material because I think of myself as an artist. And I feel like the artist's role is one that needs to challenge our surroundings and challenge expectations of the medium you're working with, expectations of what's happening around you, certainly to challenge our political system. Recently, after a turn of events, a recent election, I was interviewed for an article about making work during the time of Trump. And I, you know, one of the ways that I answered the questions that I was asked is that I've been making this work for a long time, and it's always been unorthodox or uncomfortable, or I make monsters out of clay, or oh, taboo, in some ways. But no monster that I make out of clay could ever compare to the reality of what's happening in the White House. And so I feel a new sense of inspiration in the studio to channel demons. I mean, to make the scariest thing that I could come up with. I'm still working on it, but I feel like I'm maybe a little bit off the topic, but
who
you
cares,
know.
Keep going.
All right, well, so that's what I think.
All right.
Yeah, one of the things I think the way that I bring in these some of these theories are through my work with Art Access, certainly. I mean, I think one of the things that has been happening with the organization for the last number of years is a real belief in the democratic nature of how this site is functioning and how the organization is run. And one of the things that we do is with our jury process for prospective members is actually a blind jury process that is juried by a randomly selected group of current members of the site. And so it's a real non-hierarchical way of jurying in the field. It takes out the sort of impetus of needing a certain background or educational level or whatever, because anybody that's applying to the site, no matter what their background is, could potentially be juried by somebody at a completely different level of stature in the field. And so for me, that's been one of the really exciting things about the organization. And one of the things that I think aligns kind of, I think that stems from some of the things I was talking about with Aaron Swartz, and that he really believed in and fostered the idea of everyone being able to contribute to this thing that we are a part of. And I really believe that. And I believe that everyone, no matter what your sort of level of professionalism in the field, has something to contribute and something, a unique voice that needs to be part of the organization. So, and I think with my own work, I have for many years been really interested in the fired material of ceramic as a raw material. While I use clay to make the fired material, I often envision my work working with things with the material as ceramic and not clay. And so I think that that's, at least from my own personal practice, part of a kind of a shift in thinking that has happened over the last number of years.
Do you have anything to add to that, Brett?
I'll just add one thing, which is probably more about the political side of this conversation, which is that the democratization of knowledge and information is really important, I think. I know it's important to a lot of work that Brian has done. And not so much about art making and art making as a commodity, but that that ideas and information are not a commodity, and that is actually antithetical to much of what's happening politically. Besides the social aspects of what's happening, the economic aspects of what's happening politically is really alarming. And besides the kind of inherent complications in things like WikiLeaks leaks, the idea of that becoming public knowledge is inherently good, despite those complications that come with it. So I think that's a really important thing to focus on. And my work isn't overtly political, except for that, perhaps that aspect of it.
Okay. Thank you. So I'm curious, we're talking about iconoclasm, we're talking about making work that is not the expected. And so, and this might be helpful for all people, but I specifically for the younger artists in the room, how do you remain confident in a body of work or an idea that meets resistance from an audience or from an advisor or friends? How do you handle that? What strategic mental exercises do you go through to remain focused on your idea? Or is it not a problem for you? Does antagonism just feed you? I'm looking at you, Roxanne.
I can tell where you were looking.
Yeah.
I think that the ultimate thing we're all trying to find as artists is our pure and inner voice. I think everyone's trying to do that. Doesn't matter what you're making or what medium you're working with. So to me, like, I don't really care what people think. However, of course I care what people think. So because I want to be part of the conversation. That conversation is the conversation that's happening in the art world and the community at large. I want to be able to participate in that conversation with my visual language and my work. So I don't want to be a folk artist in the studio not paying attention to what's happening. I don't want to do that, even though I might draw and make reference to folk art sometimes with my work. So Ultimately, that's what we're searching for, is finding ourselves through our work. So to me, the way that I handle somebody who might be perhaps offended by some of the imagery that I use is I just try to have integrity as a person and as an artist. And I'm on a mission to do this thing, and it's ongoing. So if I need to, I'll remind myself that no one knows my work better than myself, and this is a path towards discovery, and that's positive.
Yeah, that's excellent.
Next.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the, my work has changed a lot, you know, over the last 10 years. I've worked with a whole number of different series of bodies of work, and one of the things that is hard for me personally with a new body of work is whether or not I like it because it's new, or if I like it because it's good. And often I can't seem to tell. But one of the things that, for me personally, like when I'm walking out of the studio after working on something for a while, if I find myself just like keep looking over my shoulder, like as I like looking back at it, like, you know, as I'm leaving, I'm like, okay, there's something there that is bringing me back to that work. In terms of the confidence part, I think, you know, it's something I struggle with. I think it, you know, changing works a lot. I think it is more difficult when you're sort of pushing yourself out of your comfort zone like that. I had somebody tell me once that I gave a lecture. This was back when I was doing a lot of carving of fired ceramic, and so I would make like solid blocks of clay, and then I'd fire them, and then I'd carve them with stone carving chisels. I gave a lecture, and this guy from this art center said, you know, that's not ceramic, like that's not ceramics, you know, and he was kind of upset that I was like calling this ceramic art. And but you know, I think sometimes like things like that, I'm like, okay, well, I'm thinking about the material differently. So I was just like, that's kind of a compliment, I guess. You know, so I just turn it around and say, okay, that's good. Like
Thank
maybe,
you.
You know, yeah, like part of that function of that work was to kind of reference another material anyway. So the fact that he was upset that I was calling it ceramic was interesting.
I always feel like if I piss someone off, I've succeeded somehow.
Yeah.
So I agree with that. I think you covered, Brian Czibesz, you covered something that I was going to ask you about very well. So I'm going to ask you a slightly tweaked version, okay? So, what do you see as the future of the 3D clay technology, printing technology, and how do you think that's going to affect clay in general, and then sort of an overall huge topic, like what do all three of you see as like the future of clay, utilizing the technology and things like that? Where do you think we're going? So Brian, what do you think?
I think irrespective of the digital side of technology, I think the future of clay is in community, which I guess maybe is just saying that there's nothing new, because that's, I think, the roots of clay. So, I don't know, I guess we always want to talk about the next thing that's coming, and it's always a bit of a red herring, because not that there's never anything new under the sun, but there really isn't. And I think the digital is poised to maybe highlight some things about ourselves rather than becoming entirely a new thing, but it helps to highlight things that are inherently human. Like, we have interest in reproducibility. We have interest in manically capturing things that we feel like are ephemera. We have a desire for precision, but we also have a desire for all of the other things that define humanity. And a lot of that is about the handmade. I mean, I think it's why we have this cyclical resurgence. And it's a balance, and it's not about binaries, but about finding the thing that helps to define us after we realize the shortcomings of talking about binaries in the first place. I think the future is conversation. Actually, to maybe pick up on that, on the last question, I think that's actually, the conversation is how I know that I'm doing something right. That's how I know that there's something that's maybe incendiary, when, you know, somebody like Peter Pincus posts an image of something from a 3D printer workshop I do at RIT, and then the next thing you know, these people are just flaming it, and I think that's how I know something good's going on, that there's a conversation about what's happening.
That's awesome.
Yeah,
Anyone else have followed that guy?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a bunch of nonsense, too. I'm trying to figure out ways to undermine my own 3D printed work while I'm making it, so.
Awesome. Does anyone have a follow-up for that? And I think then we're going to move on to open it up for questions from the audience. No? Okay, if anyone has a question, there's a microphone over there. You can just step up and ask it so we can hear you. You can ask the panelists or myself. Anything you like.
Yo, Brian C. it's my first exposure to 3D printing with clay here, kind of looking around at the fab samples and all that. At the end of your talk, you were showing kind of the paired project with handmade stuff and 3D printed stuff, and you said it made you feel uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of what jumped out at me there, and I'm kind of curious if you're coming from the same place, is the theory of the uncanny valley, where something's almost human and it makes you really uncomfortable because it's so close but not quite there. Is that what you meant? Like, it's this 3D printed thing, you see what it should be, but it's not quite there and it makes you uncomfortable?
Yeah, maybe. The uncanny valley is something that I spent a lot of time thinking about in the work the research I was doing in graduate school. And so to maybe expand on it, what he means is that sort of like, I'm trying to think of examples that you might know, but in robotics, there's the push to make something that looks more and more human, right, with that sort of like synthetic skin-like flesh thing. But those things are freaking creepy, right? Like, you look at them and it makes you feel uncomfortable. And I think it's also like the undead phenomenon, right? Why the undead is so creepy in contemporary culture is because we have the sense that it's human, but it's also not exactly, and we can't really figure out what's going on with it. But I think it's unsettling to me, but the same way all simulacra is unsettling, like all representations of things are kind of unsettling to me. I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing, but because I think feeling unsettled is in many ways good. You know, we all look for comfort, but we all, I think, are driven by things that are at least slightly arresting to us. So, I'm not sure. I'm not sure where I stand on it long term. But still, I think that my suspicion maybe is grounded in that like uneasiness, and I feel like that's good.
Cool. Thanks.
Are there any other questions? Well, I have a question actually. Oh,
so
come on up.
Quick to move on.
I have one. I didn't.
You gotta go up to the mic.
I go down.
Hi. I wanted to ask Roxanne how you got to splitting open like figurative heads, and also where like these horror themes intersect with like your human themes.
Well, the one thing that I've learned is this. Okay, with the mic, I think so. Is that my process of working informs my work. And I feel like it took me a long time to really pay attention to that and learn from the process, or really think that that was a valid tool of learning about oneself. And for instance, when I was in graduate school, I made a lot of sculptures of piles of intestines that were like self-portraits or whatever. And you see, again, intestines have creeped back into my work. But looking back on that years later, it was because the process of me working, I was building forms that were solid, cutting them apart, hollowing them out with a loop tool, and all those loop carvings would look like a pile of intestines on the table. So it naturally made itself into my work, and I think that's something that shouldn't be underestimated. And so a similar thing happened with the spliced heads, because I have built, you know, I work with the figure, monster, animal, whatever it is, human. So often, I don't really think in the abstraction. I think in terms of images and representational images, but I'm not interested in making representational work. So I build a head, cut it apart, hollow it out, put it back together. But finally, at one moment when I was really paying attention to the process and totally in the moment, I realized how much I liked that spliced head, and that could be a metaphor for so many things. And open to interpretation, and then that process really kind of guided this whole series, and I just went with it, and I kind of treated it as like parameters. Like, if I was a student, this is my
assignment is to create a head and then deconstruct it into a new configuration. And then you asked about horror films. For a long time, I've referenced these moments and of transformation in horror films, whether it's sci-fi, like in the images I showed you, or horror films where a human morphs into a vampire or a werewolf or to a zombie or something else. And this is, to me, about our relationship and connection with nature and the animal world. It's showing us as animals. It's speaking to evolution. And I think I've wondered a lot about why we love these kind of horror films, and these same themes come up over and over again. And I think it's because in contemporary Western society, we're somewhat disconnected from like our primal selves. We have less outlets to express this thing that's inside of us. So I think we're drawn to these images because we are trying to better understand who we are. And I also think of it as a Jungian sort of, there's a Jungian idea behind like talking about the beast within. You know, there's a quote in my artist statement from Carl Jung that's something to effect of a gentle and a reasonable being, can easily transform into a maniac or a savage beast, but nothing could explode in us if it had not been there. And that's kind of what I'm thinking about and the inspiration that I'm taking from and borrowing from these horror sci-fi films.
Awesome, thanks.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I thought I would maybe add something
Please
to that.
Do.
I think just to sort of come off of what Roxanne was just talking about, how kind of responding to like the way that the clay was kind of piling up on the table. And I think that one of the things that I think is important to always remember is just to be aware of those things when they're happening, and to give yourself the freedom and the license to pursue it. The scaffolding series work actually stemmed from 3D printing, and I went to Teethon 3D in Omaha, Nebraska, and I was working there with Soji Satake, and we were designing these objects and 3D printing them in clay, and it's a little different process than Bryan Czibesz does, but what I really came away from that was not really a desire to make those objects, but just seeing that there was a relationship between the object and the scaffolding that supported the object in the 3D printer, or as it was going through the process of 3D printing. And then it wasn't until later that that sort of kind of filtered in and I was able to kind of like pull that resource out. But sometimes I think we become so hyper-focused and we have blinders on, and it's hard to, you know, you have to train yourself, I think, to be aware of those things that could foster new developments in your work. It's like, you know, train yourself to see those vistas that might be out there.
Mm-hmm. Did you want to add anything, Brian?
No? Okay.
There's no further questions. I have a question. Brian, Harper, your practice is probably the most distant from traditional clay processes. And while I view you as one of the most engaged figures in the field, both in academia and through your online engagement and your work, specifically as the founder of artaccess.org, but what keeps you tied to the ceramics material? And what do you think that your practice does as it relates to the entire field of ceramics?
Yeah, I think that, I mean, this is something I in some ways, a little self-conscious of, I think. But I think that, you know, I think that there are so many different ways that the material that we use on an everyday basis, there's so many different ways that it could be used. You know, clay is in so many different facets of our life. And I try to just, you know, be aware of some of those differences, you know, some of the different ways it's being used. And, you know, my role with artaccess, I see just tons and tons of ceramic work. And I'm working on the organization every day. So I think it filters in, and I think that I think maybe it's helped me kind of see the potential, you know. Mm-hmm. I think the potential of using the different, you know, using our material in so many different ways. And so I think it's I think that's one thing for sure.
Awesome. Yes.
I don't have a question so much as a comment.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, they can't hear you.
Yeah, nobody can hear you. I'll repeat it if you want. That's an interesting comment. Yeah, I can say to that that so the comment was about the theme of authority rebellion and how, as an internalized subject, rebellion, whether or not that comes through to the finished object, and so the sort of the conception of the show when I started to really think about how I was going to write about it and how I wanted to do it, I thought back to like the French and the British Academy of Art and how throughout. Periods of art making, we've had an explosion of creativity, and then there's a calcification into an authority, into an academy, or into an accepted group of standards and practices. And then there will be, you know, the Courbets, and they'll come along and they'll just say, nope, we're not gonna do that, and they do their own thing, and then they're the ones in the museum. You know, like the people who were in the academy, say, in the year of the, Gallery de Refuse is like, are they in the museums? Some of them, yeah, but a lot of the people who are the sort of the people on the outs are the people who are in the museums today. So I feel like that sort of peaks and valleys that happen, I think it's important to be aware of when we, depending on what the height or the bottom is, what you're talking about, but when we get into like an extremely calcified situation, I think it's important to be, as an artist or as just a human being, to be aware of that and to start looking outside of what you're given. You know, like when I was a kid, we had like four channels of television, and so you found something on television in four channels, or you didn't watch anything. And now we have what, thousands of ways to watch things, and we don't find anything, and then don't watch anything. So I think that it's important to kind of think about option, choice, intentionality, presentness, which all of the panelists mentioned, and an awareness of what is actually happening, both internally and externally in the world. Jerry Saltz in the keynote last night said something that really resonated with me, and that was the idea that you, as an artist, you experience your time, and by experiencing your time and making work about your experience in your time, you are having a universal connection because everyone is experiencing your time. And so you don't have to make overtly political work to be engaged in a rebellious or political action because it exists in and of itself in another plane as your engagement with your time. And so I feel that there's a validity to calling your work rebellious or whatever, even if it's not obvious in the object. And so that's, I guess, my response to the discrete object, the rebellion being there or not. In a way, it doesn't matter. Obviously, it does in pursuit to what we're talking about. We're talking about work that is evolving or new. But in a way, the creative act is enough. An old teacher of mine used to say, it's not so much that you how well you make things, it's how that you do. Yeah, which is one of the things that I think it's so important for artists to have an awareness of art history, whether in their media or in the greater field, because all the time you see undergrads or even grad students who are like, look at this thing that I just did, and then they're like, there's like five people who have done that exact thing. And granted, it's important to reinvent the wheel for yourself sometimes, but getting all self-congratulatory and patting yourself on the back about something that you've probably seen before and forgotten is, I think it's important to kind of have your awareness of those things, because you can't rebel against what exists if you don't know what exists. So.
Yeah, I would also add that I think for all of us, there's more than what we do in the world is more than our work. And because we are people that interact with other people, we talk, we have conversations with people that maybe aren't familiar with ceramics or aren't familiar with art, with a lot of artwork. And I think that part of our role, is to live that creative life and to foster that, you know, in the things that we surround ourselves with. I think for me that definitely the impetus for building Art Access came out of a rebellion against, in the early 2000s when I started brainstorming this project. It was very hard to find ceramic art online that wasn't in a commercial gallery. And when I looked at these commercial galleries, they don't want to share the artist's contact information, because they want the buyer, the potential buyer, to go to the gallery and buy that work. And so I didn't like that. I was just like, I think that this work should be out there in a non-commercial way and in a way that's accessible to anybody, and to foster a connection to the artist, and kind of more than the images, if that makes sense. And so that's kind of where it came from. I mean, back in the early 2000s, there really wasn't a lot online, but I think that's where it came from. So I guess that's what I mean by kind of fostering a creative actions in the world, using that as an extension of the impact that you can have. Part of it is through your work, and part of it is through your actions in the world.
Excellent. Okay. Does anyone have a further comment on that, or anything
else
you want
to say? I could just add a little bit to that. With the Nasty Women Project, after the election, I personally, like a lot of people, experienced this, was having a really hard time. I mean, I was having a hard time functioning, getting out of bed, going to work, talking to students, like, meaning was lost. And that the Saturday after the election, I went to a protest to Trump Tower. I live in Brooklyn. And I was with a bunch of women that were in my group, but I was with thousands and thousands of people, families, children, all ages, all races, older women, that I was like, you shouldn't have to be here protesting again. And it was very cathartic. That process was very cathartic. And it was during the moment of marching towards Trump Tower that my feelings of desperation, just despair, just all these just like things that felt, I felt so defeated, were able to transform into rage. And that rage mobilized me. And it was the Monday after the march that I posted on Facebook a call out to artists and curators for the Nasty Women. And so I guess what I'm saying is, that was rebellious, but that was kind of out of necessity for me to be able to cope through this time. And obviously a lot of people agreed, because this project and the idea behind it snowballed into something that became a reality and is now legitimately a movement that keeps growing.
Yeah,
and
it's worldwide now with shows.
So I was able to be mobilized through my rage, and then I was able to mobilize others, and then that in turn inspired me. So I think of that. That's also a rebellious outcome that had real tangible results.
Yeah, and I think that points to and it reinforces what Brian was saying about activism, and maybe to Joanne's question in a different way. That is a generative act in response to rebellion, and rebellion can feel destructive, right? It can feel personally destructive, and in many ways it's manifest in something that's destructive, but that's not a creative act. That's a destructive act. So things that are generative and creative are the right responses to the moment of feeling that confrontation which is sort of at the heart of all the things we're talking about.
That's a great insight. I think that's a really good place for us to, oh God, we've got like 30 seconds for your question. So.
Hi.
Hello.
Hey, so I might be kind of off base, but something that I see through all of your work is this like fragmenting. Like even though the visual language is really different, you all are resisting a previous narrative by like rebuilding a new narrative with fragments of pieces, like spliced faces or building a new architecture out of fired clay. And something that I think one of you said about Brian, you said rebellion as being like destructive. Do you think that maybe there's, do you guys find a difference between rebellion and resistance? Do you feel like maybe you're resisting versus rebelling? Is there a difference in your head?
If you'll answer quickly,
we ask an answer.
We'll give you a quick answer, but then we can meet you in the hallway and give you a longer one if you'd like. They're going to give us the get off the stage and like there's that's okay. So I wanted to thank all of you for coming. I really appreciate it. It was wonderful, and I want to thank all of the panelists, Roxanne, Brian, and Brian. They're really wonderful people, and I was very excited to be involved in this project. Please come to the Pacific Northwest College of Art tomorrow night for our opening. It's 5 to 8. That we're in the Commons Gallery, which has 4 other really excellent shows, and there's another 3 ceramic shows downstairs, I believe, one from their permanent collection of the now defunct American Craft Museum that used to be here, and just some really, really great work over there. So please come and see us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jones.
Thanks Jones.